In this series, you learned why and how to do cost-effectiveness analysis. You learned about DALIs and QALIs, how to present cost-effectiveness analysis results, the role for sensitivity analysis to quantify uncertainty, and how to deal with temporal issues. In this segment, we discuss how to organize a cost-effectiveness analysis for a research proposal. Specifically, we will show you research questions and basic methods for each. There are different terminologies used to present research plans. In this example, we are using the research questions approach. The topic is the cost-effectiveness of a mobile camp for adult male circumcision in rural Zambia. Notice that we have divided the cost-effectiveness analysis inquiry into three research questions focused on costs, health effects, and cost-effectiveness. The first question is, what is the cost of delivering adult male circumcision per 100 clients circumcised in this mobile camp compared with no circumcision? Question 2, how many HIV infections and disability adjusted life years or DALIs would be averted per 100 individuals circumcised in this population over 20 years? Again, the comparison is no circumcision. Question 3, what is the incremental cost per DALI averted in the population versus no circumcision? These are the key research questions. We start with cost, which is easiest to understand even for non-economists. We then proceed to health effects, which in this instance is HIV infections and DALIs. Health effects are a little harder to understand, especially the DALIs. Finally, we combine the cost and health effects to arrive at the incremental cost-effectiveness ratio. Assembling the incremental cost-effectiveness ratios is the most complex and the last step in this process. Next, let's think about methods for each of these research questions. Here we have question 1 on the cost of delivering circumcision services in more detail. The brief methods paragraph in blue is not standard in a grant application. Instead, it's for our purposes to understand broadly how we might proceed. We would probably start by reviewing financial and service records from an operating program. Typically, that's done for a 12-month period because we are in the habit of financing programs, making reports, and so on. For fiscal years. We quantify the resources used and the associated costs as well as clients served. Let me explain the phrase resources used and associated costs. It's really important in doing cost studies that we not just take the number that shows up at the bottom of the budget or expenditures page and say, well, we spent $1 million. We need to know what program inputs go into that cost amount. How many circumcision surgical kits? How many hours of surgeon and nurse time? How many building space, etc.? This detail provides useful information and also validates the cost estimates. Thus, we always specify and quantify the resources used. Another reason for this approach is that some resources may not be assigned a cost. Maybe the surgeons were borrowed from the Ministry of Health, which paid their salaries. The program budget omits these salaries. Because we are interested in societal cost, what it really costs to do this, we want to include the value of all contributed resources. Similarly, maybe the circumcision kit was donated by an international agency. If we use just the bottom line dollar number for the budget, we may overlook that. By going through a listing of personnel, supplies, equipment, and so on, we can be very clear about what resources are required to implement this program and make sure we are including all significant costs. We quantify clients served because we want to understand the cost per client served. In this example, per surgency completed, we calculate unit costs as total cost divided by clients served. This is the measure that best characterizes the cost of intervention. Question 2 is how many HIV infections and disability-adjusted life years will be averted? This assessment usually builds on empirically observed effects, such as HIV. Studies show that male circumcision reduces HIV incidence by 50% or so. However, we need to go further analytically. We can build a decision analysis model. How many total infections are prevented depends on the HIV acquisition risk in a specific population. 50% of a small risk is less than 50% of a large risk. This has to be specified. To quantify averted infections in the future requires a projection of HIV risk over time. Translating into dollars requires assigning a dollar burden to each HIV infection. This can be calculated or taken from past studies. The third RQ asks, what is the incremental cost per dollar averted? This is the incremental cost-effectiveness ratio. The numerator is net costs. Program costs adjusted for reductions in medical costs due to averted HIV infections. The denominator is dollars averted. The cost-effectiveness ratio is the most complicated outcome conceptually, since it's a ratio of two simpler outcomes. However, it's easy to calculate once you know the net costs and health effects. This question will also include the sensitivity analysis. I hope this has given you a sense of how to conceptualize and approach cost-effectiveness analysis research questions. In the next segment, we translate the cost-effectiveness analysis topic into a decision tree that guides the analysis.